Okay, thank you for that. Turretin, you now have your negative constructive, which consists of 8 minutes. You may begin when you're ready.
My presentation today is going to be on the veneration of Mary and the Bible. What does it have to say about it? The Roman Catholic Church gives Mary worship in the form of Hyper-Dulia. Whether or not that should be called worship is a separate debate. The question today is whether this is biblical. And I would tell you the answer is no, and I'll try to explain why in three parts today. The first part will be Mary as she's portrayed in the Bible. Number two, what the Bible says about the veneration of Mary. And then the third section will be responding to what Mr. Albrecht has said. So the first part, Mary's portrayal in the Bible. She's portrayed in the Bible as a relatively minor character. She's only mentioned by name once outside of the Gospels, and that's right at the beginning of the book of Acts. She's only mentioned once by name in the Gospel of Mark, and she's never mentioned by the name in the Gospel of John. Now, of course, she is mentioned in John, but just not by name. And then there's no real mention of Mary by the Apostle Paul in any of his epistles. There's only one verse of the Old Testament that clearly relates to Mary, and that's a single verse prophesying that Jesus would be born of a virgin. And so, in general, Mary has a fairly minor role in Scripture. She's portrayed, what's her character like? She's portrayed as modest and humble. She's described as being highly favored by God, and the way in which she's highly favored is that she's the one who gives birth to Jesus Christ. This term means highly favored, or which is essentially how Mr. Albrecht has translated it, not full of grace, as the Vulgate mistranslated it. Another aspect of Mary is that she's a witness to Jesus' earthly life at a number of critical points, for example, at the conception, the birth, the miracle at Cana, and the death of Christ. She's in all of these, and we see that she was interviewed by Luke in the preparation of his gospel, and possibly also by Matthew as well. And the other sort of interconnection she has with the apostles, in addition to appearing with the apostles after Jesus' ascension in that one place in Acts, is that she was cared for by John, although John doesn't actually mention her by name anywhere in his gospel. Although, of course, John doesn't mention himself by name in his gospel either. The second section that I'd like to deal with here is now, what does the Bible actually have to say about the veneration of Mary? Since, you know, generally describing her is one thing, but what about the issue of veneration? There's sort of three general positive areas where someone might think that there's an inclination in that direction. The first is the angel's greeting to Mary. The second is Elizabeth's greeting of Mary. And then the third is some general principles of love of the brethren. As for the third, there's no call just because there's a general love of the brethren and service to the brethren for us to create a special cult of Mary or a cult of Albrecht or a cult of Lane or a cult of anybody in particular. And when we talk about the veneration of Mary, we're not just talking about, you know, bringing her a cup of water when she's thirsty. We're talking about something that's especially particular to Mary, in a special reverence that's shown to her that's different from just the ordinary reverence we show to other people in following the law of God. The greetings are interesting, but mostly they just show politeness. We'll come to the argument that Mr. Albrecht presented earlier from the idea that this was some kind of titular form of the word for saying that the person is highly favored in just a minute. Moving on from the positives to the negatives, there are actually three of the Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels. They each relate an account that shows that Mary is really nothing special in the kingdom of God. Those are Matthew 12, 46 through 50, Mark 3, 31 through 35, and Luke 8, 19 through 21. They may be all the same account, they may be two or more accounts, but in these three accounts, which may or may not be more than one event, the situation is someone is trying to give Mary special attention, Mary and Jesus' brethren special attention, and Jesus turns it around and says, look, anyone who believes in me, that's my mother, that's my brethren. He's basically saying that there's an equality within the kingdom of God among all the believers, such that his mother and his brethren are nobody special. That seems to be the point that's raised in each of those, in Matthew and Mark and Luke. John doesn't have that same one, but that's fairly normal. John often doesn't include events that the synoptics include. There's a second aspect in which we can see that veneration of Mary is undone by the scriptural evidence. This second area is when Paul talks about the mother of us all. Now, recall that there's an argument that's made that Mary is our mother, and therefore we, in some sense, she's our mother because we're in Christ, and therefore we need to honor her. But when Paul talks about who's our mother, he says, the mother of us all is the heavenly Jerusalem. He doesn't view it as Mary at all, but as the heavenly Jerusalem. And then the third aspect is this title that's sometimes given in Roman Catholicism, the Mother of God, is given to Mary. But the author of Hebrews describes Jesus in this way. He says that he was without mother. And now, of course, that can't refer to his humanity, since Jesus was the son of Mary. So it must be referred to his divinity. So therefore, in view of Hebrews, it's inappropriate to call Mary by such exalted titles as the Mother of God. Now we'll turn to the third section, which is responding specifically to the points that Albrecht has raised. The first point he raised is this idea that the titular form of the word is used in Luke 1:28. But being pressed upon this, what we see is that it's simply a statement that when the participle is essentially used as a reference to the person, in other words, this is a person who is highly favored, it's not that it's being used as a title, like that it has special capital letter in Greek. Of course, they didn't have that type of mechanism in Greek in the original. Rather, what it is the fairly rare word is only used a couple of times. It's only used maybe in a similar way only two times in the New Testament, in this place and in Ephesians 1:6. And in Ephesians 1:6, of course, it's not used as a title. There's not any particular reason to view it as a title here, except for a desire to use it as a title later. No one ever else calls her by that title, and we're not suggested in that passage to use that as a title. Let me move on to the second argument. The second argument is that all generations will call her blessed. This argument, again, is actually a statement of fact that all generations will call her blessed. It's not a command to do so. The third argument was an argument from Galatians, I believe it was chapter 5, verses 13 and 14. Perhaps it was chapter 3. But in any event, the idea was that we serve one another in love. Well, the idea is not that we shouldn't give Mary a glass of cold water if we see her and she's thirsty. The question is whether or not we're supposed to give her some kind of special cultus in the terms that the Roman Catholic Church would use to describe the worship. Then the fourth argument was, behold your mother, but as we brought out during the cross-examination, this is not a command for all Christians, just a command for John. And, of course, John in his gospel never commands us to worship Mary or to venerate her in any way.